I think I turned up in the England squad and Phil Jagielka played more times in goal than I had in the Premier League.
Making saves, that's almost the easy part of being a goalkeeper. Because you play, isn't it?
It's not.
What is your favourite piece of football memorabilia that you own?
Messi shirt.
I've got a signed Messi shirt.
No way, I was only bantering there from that game.
From that game. Yeah.
Hi everyone, here we are for another episode of Off The Shelf. With me, Michael Dawson, and my co-host, Paul Miles. How are you, mate?
Good as gold, Dawes. How are you?
I'm always well. Always well coming. Look at this unbelievable training centre.
And we've got another very special guest today, and someone you'll know well from your career. And he's a great guy to have about the place. Great goalkeeper. Came in at the back end of last season. Absolutely fantastic. And I'll let you introduce him, because you'll no doubt come up against him a few times in your career.
I have, but I never scored against him. So, unfortunately, he's got the bragging rights today. But Fraser, great to have you, mate. Nice to see you. Another northerner. Can't beat him. We're taking over down here.
Yeah.
Fraser, let's start at the start. Growing up in Hexham, up in Northumberland. I mean, what was it like growing up as a kid? Were you always into football? Was that always going to be the thing for you?
Yeah, for sure. Like, love football. I was a Newcastle fan growing up. And obviously, that period, Newcastle were doing well. Obviously, Kevin Keegan beat Man United.
I'd love it if we beat them. Love
that
it.
That one. No, it was good. Like, we lived in like a small village. Wasn't a lot going on. Got three brothers, so we're just in the garden playing football all the time. And yeah, obviously love football and kind of stumbled my way into it in the end. But yeah, always kind of wanted to do that.
You went to the Royal Grammar School of Newcastle. I've done all my research, mate. Don't worry about that. How were you at school?
Oh. Educationally wise,
everything
average. It was a tough school. Like, it was a very good school. I was very fortunate to go there. Obviously, parents worked hard to send me there. Tried hard within that spectrum of that school, probably average.
Tried hard, lacked ability.
Yeah.
Yeah, I definitely got that as well. But mine wasn't a grammar school.
But yeah, it was obviously a good school to be at. Yeah. Predominantly rugby school, played rugby out of school for a bit, just for like Tynedale, which is, just long from Hexham. Enjoyed it, just loved all sport, like a lot of kids, played tennis, golf a bit. But yeah, kind of played whatever position in rugby. Once hit my growth spurt, there you go, second row.
All the fun. Told you.
All the fun's gone. Just getting smashed up all the time.
Well, at least you didn't get cauliflower ears in that little time, so that's a bonus.
Always a win, that, isn't it? And then, yeah, obviously played like football on a Saturday, Sunday. Just village team. Started as a centre back, and I think the keeper, when we're under 12s, the keeper moved up an age, and then we're like, we didn't have a keeper, so fancy a go, and then been there ever since.
Told you, always work your way back. I started as centre forward and ended up with centre half. Fraser started centre half and ended up with goal.
I mean, Dawes, this is what I know, seriously, though. When you think of Fraser's career now, isn't it amazing how you get these little moments of fate? Like they say, the goalkeeper moves up, Malaysia. You haven't got a goalkeeper, in you go, Fraser, and you end up being an England goalkeeper.
Yeah, it's mad.
It's mad when you think about it, isn't it?
When you look back, it's mad because you'll be the same. You'll be able to pick probably five or six people who have been influential throughout your career, who might have just seen something in you and thought, we'll give them a chance, when probably ability-wise you didn't really deserve that, but they just see something in you and that little bit of belief, and I don't know, looking back, you're like, luckily they did, otherwise, I don't know what I'd be doing.
When did football start taking over from what you were doing at school, and when did you start to believe that, hang on a minute, I'm pretty decent at this?
Still waiting for it. it was a bit of a strange one for me, because obviously at school we couldn't actually play school football till we were 16, kind of GCSE year. So outside of school, I snuck into like county football, was playing for Northumberland. Up in Newcastle, they had like a city schools thing, so they'd pick like the best kids from the schools in Newcastle and you'd play whoever. So that was kind of started happening when I was 15. And then off the back of that, kind of had a few trials at a few clubs, like when I was 15, nothing came of them. And then started A-levels at school, and then literally just got a call out of the blue from the head of scouting at Newcastle, and they basically said, "Oh, we want you to come in for a couple of days. We've got FA Youth Cup, but we've only got one keeper who's the right age, basically." So they were basically looking for a number two. So they were rifting through lads, trying to find someone. So they were basically like, come in, train a few days, we'll see how you are. So anyway, I went in, did okay, obviously. And then they kind of kept saying, I'll come in, you know, kind of, can you come in 2 days a week? So I'm trying to balance that off against like trying to do my A-levels. But obviously, yeah. I really want to go down the football route. So kind of over that season, I started just going in more and more. And then, it wasn't until 17 they actually offered me a youth contract, like a YT contract. And then, obviously.
Did you have to make a decision then? Like, because you're doing A-levels.
Yeah, it was obviously kind of tough because school was suffering and I was trying to go there and do football, do school. So kind of school was suffering a bit. But then, obviously, when you get that opportunity, you can't really say no. But then I ended up actually, once I signed that contract, I kind of went in a year later than, because normally you'd start your YT at 16.
Yeah.
So I kind of got a two-year YT when I was 17. And then the following year, obviously, you kind of do education maybe 1.5 days a week in the academy. So instead of doing the education that we did at the club, my parents were quite like, I want you to get a couple of A-levels. So I'd go in and I did two A-levels, but kind of one each year. So I'd go in kind of 1.5 days a week, and I did psychology 1 year.
Oh, wow.
And then I actually stayed at school like an extra year. So I actually finished school when I was 19, because I wanted to get the second A-level, so I did economics. And then, but yeah, it was so hard to do because you're, God, heart's fully in football. And
you want the dream then.
Yeah,
going back to your grassroots, Wall's End Boys.
Yeah, so that was quite
because of that Shearer, Michael Carrick.
Were you aware of yourself? The history of the club before you?
It's well known, by the way, around the name of that football team.
It's a prestigious thing there. I probably didn't go there till I was 15, 16.
Right.
So I wasn't there that long a time, but obviously it's a massive.
Was there anyone else in your team that went on to have a career in the game?
Probably not at Wall's End. Probably not my age group at Wall's End, but obviously you're fully aware, obviously Peter Beard.
Yeah.
And then he was one of my coaches at Newcastle, Shearer, Carrick. So being up north, like it's a big thing to be.
All the kids want to play for them and think the dream might come true. Yeah. I can make it.
Yeah. So you're at Newcastle, and you're at the club that you know you dreamed of as a boy. I mean, look, when you joined, first day through the door. I mean, that must have been a special day, right?
Yeah, so when I joined, it was, obviously I'd been going in that previous season, but once you start going in there, it's really kind of daunting because I've gone from private school into a completely different environment. Like, you'll know what football's like. And obviously you're absolutely delighted to be there. But obviously that first year, I was always kind of like basically on trial for most of the year. And then, it was like amazing. Obviously, you get the days where you get to go up with the first team and, you know, Shea Given, Steve Harper.
What two great goalkeepers.
Unbelievable. Yeah. And they were brilliant for me. You know, two great guys who couldn't help you enough. And it was just amazing. And then it's all the steps you tick off on the way. Obviously, you go in and you're buzzing to be there to begin with. And you get your YT and then you're buzzing with that. And then it's like, oh, I want to get pro. And then, like, I'll never forget that day where you sat in the classroom and the whole team's going in one after each other. And it's like, nah, we're released here. No, we're keeping you. And, like, it's when I think the first lad walked in and everyone was like, oh, he's definitely getting one. And he didn't get one. And then everyone else in the room was just like,
you're almost thinking, what are they looking for then if he's not got one?
Like, he was a great lad, worked so hard, did everything.
This is reality of football, though, isn't it?
Oh, it's so hard. Right? But even when I first went in, like, I walked in the door and I'm 6'6", gangly, never done a weight in my life. So football on the pitch in the morning, weights in the afternoon. And you're seeing all these lads who've been in the academy for 10 years or whatever, who have trained, like, they're all in great nick, they've all done gym, and then I'm there doing, I can't even do 10 press-ups. Keeper coach is like, I'll take you for a bit. I couldn't even do 10 press-ups. And I was just like, but then seeing that really kicks you into gear, because the whole way through my career, I've always been working hard. That's always been me. Like, probably not the most talented or, like, God-given ability, but just works, like, non-stop the whole
time. Get every ounce out of it.
Yeah. What age did you think, Fraser, I can follow my dream and be a professional footballer? Because you came into it late. At 17, you touched on kids that had been at Newcastle since probably the age of 9, 10, and went all the way through and then get released at 17. You're 18. You're only just coming into it at that age.
Yeah, like, it's so hard. I think even once you get into it, you're still, like, you never feel like you've made it, weirdly. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
no, I agree,
You still feel like you're chasing something, or, and there's so much competition around you. And even when I signed my YTS at Newcastle, like, I was buzzing, worked so hard over the summer, like, be ready to start my YT. Came in, and I think a week later, the club signed Tim Krul. So paid money for him, bought him from Holland, and then same age, and you just thought, well, that wasn't part of the plan. And then, and then it's like, it's just every step of the way, there's always a challenge or something you've got to get past. And
especially
it's like that the whole way
through your
career.
As a young goalkeeper though as well.
Oh, yeah,
because opportunities are even fewer, aren't they?
Yeah, it was like, even that first year at Newcastle was hard because you've got, like, the games on the Saturday, but only one keeper can play.
Yeah.
So then you're not playing there. So then they're arranging, like, Tuesday night games against, like, local teams. And, like, that group of lads, like, I just remember it, like, that group of lads who weren't playing on the Saturday, and then you're turning out against whoever on the Tuesday in kind of no-win games because you're at Newcastle United. Like, it doesn't matter if you're first team under 18, like, you should be beating whoever. And you're turning up these horrendous places, like, and you're trying to do well to kind of get in, and it's hard, but
it's a hard age. It's a hard age because your mindset's everywhere. If you're not in the starting 11 and you're playing in the bomb squad, as it's called, you think, wow. So you were there for 6 years, Fraser?
Yeah, there for 6 years. Never played in the first team.
Is that something that, like, still is think, I follow Newcastle if I could have just made an appearance?
I think it's probably, I'd say Newcastle and Liverpool are similar in ways where, because it's such a big thing to play for those clubs as a homegrown player, because, like, in Newcastle, there's not a lot going on. Like, everyone goes to St. James's on a Saturday. So, like, the town's dead because everyone's at football.
Yeah.
And then having been, like, a kid and going watch their games and whatever, that's obviously something I wish had happened. But looking back, I'm like, if I could change one thing, I'd have played just one game at St. James's for Newcastle. It didn't happen. Yeah. And obviously my career took a different route. And
we often talk about loan spells and, you know, how important they can be within a career. I mean, you look at a lot of players here where that was the case. And for you, I mean, the loan spells worked beautifully, didn't they?
Yeah.
Won the title at Norwich, for instance, before obviously you went up to Celtic. What was, you know, finally getting a run of games and being part of a team, what was that like for you? And what did that do for you?
Yeah, amazing. Obviously, before Norwich, I'd had a couple of, like, one-month loan spells, but Norwich was the first one for me. Obviously, a massive, like, a big club that had just dropped from the Championship, and then they'd had a tough first month, and Paul Lambert came in as manager there, and then he called me up, said, oh, do you want to come? Well, I mean, it was a no-brainer, really. But even, like, situations that puts you in, like, I turned up on a Friday night at Hartlepool. I'd never met the team, never trained with the team, never met the manager. And it's like, oh, you're playing tomorrow? And you're just like, okay.
But do you think you could have done that in any other position apart from a goalkeeper?
Nah. No chance. I think...
Surreal, isn't it? All right, guys.
And that's hard as a young lad as well.
Yeah.
Because you just, like, feel like you're thrown in, but...
Yeah.
I don't know.
Sink or swim, though, isn't it?
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. But also, like, great belief from the manager to just be like, there you go. But, yeah, that season was crucial for me. Obviously, it's a big club. You start playing in front of 20-odd thousand. Yeah.
Pressure games as well.
Pressure games. Want to get promoted. But Paul Lambert was brilliant with me. Like, you know, when you have a manager who just installs confidence in you, it's just like, just keep it out the net, don't care how, like, unbelievable. probably doesn't believe it himself, but just made you
What
feel,
age were you there for, sorry?
21.
Wow, young as a goalkeeper. Yeah. Young.
I mean, look, it's a big club, really. Like, Norwich is a big club, and at the time was, you know, underachieving. But yeah, you just get chucked in and absolutely loved that season. Obviously, we go on, end up being champions. You know, it was fantastic.
Talking about big clubs, you next make an impact at Celtic. Now, I always say to people, you just cannot underestimate the size of Celtic Football Club. You walk through the door there. Tell us what you find.
Yeah, massive. I think, like you say, I think until you go and see that football club for what it is, you'll never believe it. Like, it's massive and then some.
The global and reach of it.
Yeah, like, unbelievable. And then you're going into an environment where you have to win every game. Like, you've got Rangers across the city. If they win, like, you have to win. You can't drop points. So, yeah, walked in the door there. Obviously, I was still quite young in goalkeeping terms. Mm-hmm. Like, massive club. You're going in and playing with, like, international players, like, established players. So that was tough, I think, to then almost find that bit of confidence where you need to go from being, like, a young lad to, well, I'm here to be the number one.
Yeah, yeah.
But, yeah, huge club and, I don't know, obviously, love my time there. Can't speak highly enough.
Very successful as well.
Yeah,
individually,
very successful. Yeah.
And collectively.
Yeah, I mean, obviously, to go and then, you know, play Europa League, Champions League, that kind of kicked me on into the England squad.
Most clean sheets consecutively. Did you know that one?
Yeah,
you didn't know.
I forget that one. That was a
you
big,
don't forget. Come on.
No, honestly, like, it is funny. Like, you, I don't know. You look back to individual moments, or especially there, the fans are so passionate and it's amazing, and you build that connection with the fans really well there. And
is it true you can't go anywhere around the city? I played with David Marshall, and Marshall said it was like everywhere you went, everyone just knew you.
Everywhere. But I think in Scotland as well, like everywhere you go, it's like, oh, it's such and such. Or, yeah. Or like, obviously, if you have an old firm and you win, it's amazing.
If you lose, you don't go out.
If you lose, yeah, not going out anywhere for at least a month.
I mean, this is some game in it, Celtic, right? Tell us about the old firm.
Yeah, massive. I mean, you'll have an old firm in a month's time and you're getting asked questions about that. Yeah. They're not worried about the games leading up to it, but just huge games. And obviously when that rivalry is there and you're close in the league and the points are tight, like, they must win. But yeah, just amazing games. Like, honestly, if you're a football fan, you have to go to one. Like, you just have to go. Like, some of them probably end up being not the best football just because of the pressure around it. You don't want to lose, but you want to win.
It's the noise, Fraser. That's what I mean. Even watching it on telly, it's just the noise that comes through.
You get back after, like, you play the game and your ears are ringing for 24 hours after. Like, honestly, like, you get in the car and you can't hear properly because it's that loud. But just amazing games. Like, to when you go and then you win one of them, it's like,
did it bring you more pressure? Do you know, as a keeper, I take my hat off to you, because as a defender, you make a mistake, at least I need you to bail me out of trouble. As a keeper, you've got no one. Did it bring more, you felt the tension? Or did you have that every time you played for Celtic?
Nah, I think when you're young, for sure. Because I remember when I went back on loan, obviously, for a year from Southampton back to Celtic. And one of the first, I think the second game was an old firm. And I remember being away at Ibrox the second time, going, I never really felt like this when I was there the first time. Like, I felt so calm and I felt in my bubble.
Yeah.
But when you're young and you're trying to build that, you don't have that experience behind you. So then, but yeah, it was just amazing, because, you know, if you win, you've made all of these people's months and they've got the bragging rights to the next one. And
you didn't have that fear. That's what it looked like you were going to say. You didn't have that fear as a young player. I didn't when I was young. And then all of a sudden you go back for the second stint. You're more experienced. You've got more expectations. You're now a senior player in the dressing room. Did you feel that?
Yeah, definitely. Because I think when you're younger, I think it's normal to have that. Like, you need to rack up those experiences. Yeah. You need to make those mistakes. And the thing that Celtic was, you don't get that chance to make those mistakes because you're a massive club and always made a mistake. Like, you're immediately under pressure if you've made a mistake. Whereas, obviously, as you get older, like everyone will know, it's part of football, yeah. and you have to just move on from it. Like, you don't mean to do it or whatever. But I think, like, it was hard to go from, even like you'd played in front of 25,000 or whatever at Norwich. There's a big difference to that to going 60,000 Old Firm. Yeah. So it took me a while, the first 6 months at Celtic, to kind of find my feet and settle. That was definitely a big jump. But then I remember I saved the penalty in like the last minute of game against Hearts when we were kind of struggling a bit. And just kind of kicked on from there. Just gave me that confidence that I'd been looking for and searching for a bit.
There's one game in particular that people still talk about. And look, even being here at Spurs at the time, I watched it. And it was incredible when you're obviously Barcelona 2-1. I've got the Messi quote in front of me. The performances of Fraser Forster against us was talked about for a long time. There was one game in Scotland when he was not human. It is the best goalkeeping performance I have seen. When Victor Valdez said he was leaving Barcelona, we either talked about him playing here. From Lionel Messi.
Nice, isn't it?
The Great Wall, he called it.
Great Wall.
Yeah, Great Wall. Wow. Nah, obviously. Wow.
I mean, talk about being in the zone. I mean, to beat that Barcelona team at any time was something special. But to be in a Champions League game for Celtic, it must have... what was it like?
Oh, it's amazing.
I'm trying to find the words of what that must have been like.
It's impossible to put into words. I mean, we'd played them away, I think, 2 weeks earlier, and we lost 2-1 in the last minute. And, like, I'd made saves. But I think the performance we put in away from home really carried us on into the home one because we knew we'd have the fans with us. But yeah, it was just one of those nights where just everything kind of...
And do you know when you're in that zone?
Yeah, you know, like you make a couple of saves early and you're like...
You're almost like, come on, bring it on.
Yeah, and that team as well. I mean, if you don't enjoy playing those games, do you know what I mean? But the noise that night as well. And obviously we ended up going, I think, 2-0 up and they scored right at the end. But it was just kind of unbelievable. Just kind of everything... It was just one of those days where you're just in the zone and everything goes your way and you're seeing the ball as if it's, you know, a gym ball. And yeah, just amazing. I think, yeah, I think after that night, I didn't sleep after that game. And then, just amazing. You know, I think obviously fortunate to play in those games. And like I said before, like the fans, half of my memories of that game is the atmosphere and the fans. Yeah. And a lot of it's, the memories of that rather than that save or this save. It was just...
The occasion more. Yeah.
It's nice when Messi says that though, isn't it? Oh, imagine that.
I mean, it's just but it is. It's almost like it's almost like you don't need it, but it's almost like a validation from the greatest player, you know, in the world at the moment or at that time saying nice things about you. I mean,
it's always nice when someone in the game as well, it carries a lot more weight. And but like I say as well, that obviously the period kicked me on into the England squad and it's an amazing time and one I'll remember forever.
You touched on there, Fraser, about getting an England call-up, making your debut against Chile in 2013. How proud was that? And was that a goal that you set yourself?
Yeah, definitely. I think obviously as a kid, you dream of playing for your country. And it was obviously I got in the squad. I was the only one who wasn't playing in the Premier League at the time, so that was another little kind of nice step into it. And obviously fantastic to make my debut. It was a tough game. Obviously, we'd made a lot of changes and stuff, and Chile were a very good team.
Yeah, decent,
and
yeah.
But like to go and play for England and pull on that number one shirt, again, it's something you'll never forget and something you'll treasure forever. And like a really proud moment, because I think it's when you start reaching those things like the Champions League and making the England debut, you know, you can look back. And I remember the first game I played in the Champions League. I think I texted everyone who I felt had really helped me along the way just to say thanks for
a lovely touch.
That's a lovely touch.
And, But now it's obviously amazing to play for England and what every kid dreams of, yeah, one day.
How was it going to big tournaments? And at that time, Joe Hart was generally number one and playing in most games. How was it going to tournaments thinking, I'm maybe not going to play? I always wonder as a number two, look, I experienced, I went as a cheerleader, I went for a golf trip, I went for the experience, which was incredible in 2010. And I probably knew I wasn't going to play, but as a keeper, it's probably even more that
yeah,
you have to wait for an injury.
It's really tough. I think, obviously, I went to Brazil 2014. Yeah. That was the first one. I went as the number three. So you're thinking, a lot's going to have to happen.
Yeah.
But at the group at the time, we had Joe Hart, Ben Foster. So we all got on. Like,
great,
we had so much
there.
Fun.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, yeah.
We had so much fun as a group. We trained really well. Standard was amazing. But we all just got on so well. Mm. Like, we'd all go and smash the gym together and go and play golf together or whatever. And we just had a great time as a group. And we all were kind of the mindset. We didn't understand Joe's playing. And me and Ben were obviously we just need to help him be in the best place possible. So I think you have to kind of understand your role in the squad. And yeah, obviously on a personal note, you want to be playing. Mm. But you go into a major tournament and you have to do what you need to do to help the team. Similar to now, really. Like, you have to kind of, yeah, you can be frustrated you're not playing, but you have to help everyone around you. And so, yeah, obviously the Euros after that as the number two, obviously neither tournament went as well as we wanted, which, you know, is frustrating. But obviously you go, you train well, you be good around the place, and if you needed, you needed.
What's it like being in, I mean, you're playing in a World Cup in Brazil, and you think, like, when you're a kid growing up, you're just thinking, well, imagine being involved in a World Cup in Brazil. But you're very much sort of in a bubble, really, aren't you? You don't really get to see a lot of it, do you?
No, not at all. Brazil especially was, we're in a hotel and then couldn't leave the hotel. And then it was like training took us about an hour to get to each way just because of traffic around the place. So you're seeing everything from the bus and you're just like, but you never get to go out and
you don't
and
get
see
to feel
lot,
it,
no.
Do you? Yeah.
So you go to these tournaments and it's just all football. Like, there's no, similar to all of football, like, you'll go to all these different places, but you'll be in a hotel the whole time, play the game, and then you're out of there. Like, you don't really see any of these places.
Did you have any jokers in the squad in them two tournaments? How did you fulfil your time, apart from playing golf?
We had a great group. Phil Jagielka was good value for money.
You need good characters, though, don't you? You're away for a long time.
You have to, yeah. Especially in that group who's not playing, because all the situations in the group are hard. You've got the lads who are playing who they also need to be able to switch off, and the game might not go well, so they need lifting. So you need the lads around the squad to lift them. You've also got the lads who aren't playing who are frustrated, but you might play the next game. But you need to, in those tournaments, you can't have people who sulk or whatever. Yeah. You need people to bring energy if they're not playing, and you just got to be ready because you never know what's around the corner. So the squad dynamic's crucial, and I think that's noticeable in club football even more now, that you need lads who are good around the place when they're not playing as much as they are now.
Club-wise now, Southampton, and you had a long spell there. I just remember every time we played you, you just made loads of saves. It was really frustrating.
But, just took his arms out. Yeah, post, there you go. No one's going to pass for us.
But it's interesting. I mean, obviously, you made your Premier League debut. I think you were about 26, weren't you?
Yeah, so 26.
I mean, what was that like?
Yeah, mad, because like we said before, you have all of these things you dream of doing as a kid, and then I played for England before playing the Premier League. And, I think I turned up in the England squad and Phil Jagielka played more times in goal than I had in the Premier League. do you know what I mean? And then, but now that was obviously another one where it's another new thing. And obviously Southampton came in for me, and timing was probably right for everyone. I think Celtic obviously did well at the deal and stuff, and timing was right for me to come to the Premier League and give that a go. And obviously it was nice. It was a good move.
Had a great time at Southampton. Your contract comes to an end. Did you have any other opportunities, any other clubs to go to before you joined the mighty Spurs?
Do you know what? It was one of them where as soon as my agent rang and said Spurs are interested, I was like, I want that one. It was like a no-brainer for me. Mm. Obviously, the situation coming in, Hugo's here and whatever, and I wasn't sure of what it would look like for me, really, like being realistic. But when a club like this comes along, like not many players actually get to be at clubs like this in their career. And, you know, I was just like, I want that one. I'll come, throw myself into it, train well, give it everything, play the games I play, just embrace it for what it is. And, you know, it's been a fantastic move for me.
What was it like just getting to, you know, getting ingrained here? Because, you know, obviously, you know, Hugo was here and he's been here since 2012. He's captain for a long time.
Yeah.
Institution here, really.
Yeah.
And obviously, you coming into the squad. How were you accepted? What was Hugo like? How did it all work?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, I wasn't stupid. I know what Hugo's done and achieved in the game, and he's been a huge part of this place for a long time. So, as a way, I might come in and not feature that much or whatever, but I was like, you know, I'll embrace the challenge and see where it takes me, basically. But it's one of them. It was easy coming because I knew a few of the lads from England. So I came in the door and, you know, it was dead easy, really. It's probably been one of the easiest transitions, probably the easiest I've made. Obviously a bit older as well. And yeah, probably the easiest transition I've had to make in football, to be honest.
And you ended up playing quite a few games last season in the end, didn't you?
Yeah, ended up playing a lot of games, which was obviously nice because not playing is frustrating, but and everyone wants to play. But no, obviously it was great to play. And, you know, last season didn't end up going the way we all wanted, but, you know, felt like I did everything I could. I came in, I worked hard when I wasn't playing, tried to be good around the place. And I'd like to think I contributed in the games that I did.
100% you did.
Contributed
yeah.
in saving that penalty against Forest, no? Another one of my former clubs. Didn't affect him staying up though, so he didn't mind that other phrase. Made some big saves at big times.
Yeah.
And it must have been nice just to get that opportunity. I know it was at Hugo's expense, but you wait, don't you?
Well, that's what football is, isn't
yeah,
it?
I mean, of course it is.
If you're not playing, either your chance either comes through an injury or a dip in form from someone else, and you never wish that on anyone. But it's just the way the squad in football is. So it was obviously nice to come in, got to play in the Champions League again. And yeah, you know, I think made saves. And, you know, I think it was a shame the way the season ended up because, you know, for a long period of it, we were in a good
place. Started really well.
Yeah.
Just, I'm quite fascinated by the when you look at your career, obviously you had the time at Newcastle and you didn't play a first team game, then obviously you went loan, then Celtic, incredible, back to Southampton, a regular, then you come to Spurs and you're coming in as a number two. Now again, number two, Vic's come in and he looks the part, to be fair, doesn't
yeah.
he? The mentality of it though, through, you know, being number one, being number two, as a goalkeeper day to day, I mean, is it obviously it's something you think about, but is it something that affects you? How does it work, sort of mentality and what you do every day? And you have got to be ready to play, obviously.
Yeah, that's the thing as well. I think when you take that step and you probably know you're going to be the number two, it's actually harder than when you're not playing because obviously you're disappointed you're not playing. You want to be playing, but you've got to train well and be ready. Like we saw last
always
season,
ready.
You've got to.
Yeah.
Be always ready. You're a red card away from getting on or an injury or whatever, so you just have to train well, do everything you can, work hard and be ready for if and when called upon, because as a keeper it just happens like that as well. I mean, less so now but back in the day it was keepers brought down the striker, it's red card, penalty,
yeah.
you're on.
Yeah.
So I think like you have loads of different things that test your mentality as a player. You have long-term injuries, you have manager doesn't fancy you out of the team, or you're not playing but you want to get in the team. But ultimately, when you're not playing, you want to get in the team. So you have to train well, because he's not going to pick you if you're not training well. And then you have to be ready for when that opportunity comes.
Yeah.
So mentality-wise, you've just got to work as hard as you can and be a good guy around the place, support the one who's playing, help the younger keepers.
I was just going to say, I was going to mention Brandon and Alfie. It comes down to having respect for your number one,
yeah.
and then also for the younger kids that are looking up to you, Alfie, and a 24. So they look, you're now a senior, 35 years old, thinking, look, I'm not going to mope around and spit me dummy out. That's just how you train and be prepared when called upon.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I was very lucky having Steve Harper and Shay Given.
Yeah, like, I played with Harps and he was like that at number
he
two.
He was fantastic.
Yeah.
And then, like, still keep in touch with him and Shay, and they were fantastic for me. Couldn't have helped me anymore. And then now as you get a bit older as well, it's as much, you need to support the one who's playing, you need to help the ones who aren't, you need to help the academy lads when they're training with the first team. Like, you have a big appreciation of the one who's playing and how hard that is. So you've got to be able to help them any way you can. You've got to be good around them. But then, yeah, you want to just help people as well. You want to help the young lads when they come and train with the first team. And because I remember what that was like when you come across and you're absolutely buzzing. And I don't know, you just want to see people do well around you and try and help any way you can.
Fixing's a big character and he looks a great goalkeeper. What have you made of him so far?
Yeah, he's been brilliant. I think his performances in the games have been very good, made big saves. Not easy coming to a new club, new country.
Does he speak English?
Yeah, his English really is very good, which has obviously really helped him. One of my mates from Celtic actually played with him at Empoli, and he's raved about him for ages. So as soon as he was coming here, like he said, like, very, very good keeper, top guy.
Character, isn't he?
Yeah, and he's, you know, he's been brilliant in the games and been good around the place, trains well, works hard, and yeah, so it's a great start for him.
Fraser, we touched on it a little bit earlier, the pressures of being a number one, playing in goal, and when you make mistakes, how do you deal with it?
It's a lot easier as you get older and you've got that experience behind you. I think for me, when I was younger, I used to beat myself up way too much. I was one of them, and then putting more pressure on yourself, and ultimately you made a mistake, it's a goal. But as you get older, I think you realise that just doesn't work for you. Like, you need that consistency. And I think you've just got to believe in where you're going. Like, it's part of the game. Like, everyone makes them, but you're the one who's picked out for the goal. Happens to defenders, to be fair, as well. Like, they can make a mistake, it's a goal. Strike, you kick it wide, no one cares.
Always have a goal, don't they? Get paid all the money, get all the plaudits, miss a chance, and we get blamed.
Yeah, literally.
But you've also got now, Fraser, where the goalkeeper's has sort of evolved into, you're now a sweeper as well. You've got to be able to just float passes out or take it in under pressure. The way goalkeeping has evolved, and you're great off your feet, so you'll probably find it easy. But that's something that people don't really talk about, the evolution of a goalkeeper.
It's probably the position. I know all the positions have evolved, but it's probably the position that's evolved the most, because now it's not about just making saves. Like, you have to be good with your feet. You have to play high for three balls so the team can go and press. So it's changed so much even in just the last 5 years. So you've got to constantly be learning and adapting. And that's where training was crucial, because you have to be doing these things in training to them. It's not like you can just turn up on a Saturday and go, oh, today I'm going to play 35 yards outside my goal. Do you know, like, you need to work hard on these things. And but it's changed so much. I think obviously we see Edison at Man City and he's one extreme. Like, there's very few of them knocking around. Like, so calm with his feet, so good with his feet. But yeah, I think as much as that, it's getting that relationships with your back four, knowing when I get the ball, he's going to be there for me, and trusting he is going to be there for me. So it's hard when you come in for a game, because starting 11 is normally pretty much the starting 11. So then when you do come in, it's hard to then just be able to turn it on, because you haven't actually built those relationships. But I think every game, even as a team, the way we want to play, we look better and better at what we want to do, because those relationships are coming and they can only get stronger and better as the season goes on.
It's funny now, isn't it, Fraser? Because, like, making saves, that's almost the easy part of being a goalkeeper. You've never tried it. You've got to talk for 90 minutes. You've got to play off your feet. You've got to push the line up. You've got to organise. It's almost like making saves are almost a given, aren't they, really? People don't talk about making saves anymore.
But that's the thing, you've got to be good at all the aspects, and people are quick to come for you if they think you aren't. So, but ultimately as well, I think I'll be a bit more of a traditionalist, and I'll make myself sound old. But for me as well, first and foremost, you have to just keep the ball out the net.
Yeah, 100%.
Like, I think that's key, because if you're conceding goals, if you concede two goals, it's you're then asking a lot more of the people in front of you to go and score three. For me, first and foremost, like, you just have to keep the ball out the net, and then the rest's very important, don't get me wrong, but you don't want to be shipping a load of goals, ultimately. But like you say, there's so much more and more demanded from keepers now, and I'm sure it's just going to keep going that way as well over the next few years.
But you're still loving it?
Oh, yeah, love it. Like, love coming to training every day. Love just getting balls smashed at me in training. I think when you're not loving it anymore, that's the time. You don't want to do it anymore. I mean, I'm only 35. I've still got... I'm aiming for
at least
40.
10 years.
Plenty of years left in you yet, mate.
Yeah.
And keep going as long as you can, especially in a training ground like this. I mean, it's phenomenal. I was fortunate. I was only here for 18 months when we had this. But I come back and I just think, wow.
But that's the thing, like, if you don't enjoy coming to work here, where you've got this training ground, you get to go, the stadium's ridiculous. Like, I remember seeing the stadium being built and thinking, I have to play there. Like, luckily I've ended up coming here, which makes it easier. But even as an away player, I was just like, I just want to play one game in that stadium. And then you turn up at the training ground, and every year you come, like, last year was amazing. Turn up this year, we've done more work, even better. Like, it's just amazing to see. And like we were saying, if you don't enjoy coming here to work, then you've got serious problem.
You certainly have. And Fraser, as we sit here today, thank you very much. Busy schedule, training to go in this afternoon, but thanks for taking the time out, mate. Appreciate
my pleasure.
It. Cheers, Fraser. But before we go, we've got 7 questions for you.
We've got some Q&A.
Oh, no.
Go on.
Quick fire questions. Well, I think we'll have to adapt these a little bit, won't we?
Just make them up as you
We'll have to adapt. Right, so what is your favourite piece of football memorabilia that you own? Probably a shirt or gloves you might have swapped.
Messi shirt.
I've got a signed Messi shirt.
No way, I was only bantering there from that game.
Yeah, that's probably my favourite.
Oh, that's magnificent. Brilliant.
Brilliant.
Nice Brilliant. Is that pride of place at home, or you keep it somewhere?
No, I don't. I don't have any football memorabilia on show.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah. Bit weird.
Get away from it when I get home?
A little bit. Plus, I've always been one of them where I'm not big for looking back. I know, like, we've sat and gone over
your whole career.
Yeah. It's nice to do, like, when you do something this, but day to day, I'll
tell you why it's
nice
to do it,
Fraser,
because you never get the opportunity to do it.
Yeah, that's...
You're always looking forward, This is your career.
But in 10 years, Fraser, when you finish, you'll do it, and then you'll appreciate what you've achieved. Look, I'm 2 years retired now, and you think, go back and I have kids, and I go, oh, yeah. Even when I come here, I think, God, I actually played on there and trained. You just take it because your next training session is the most important, the next game.
But even where you said about the clean sheet record, like, obviously, it's an amazing thing. I'm like, oh, yeah, I did do that. But, like, for me, like, day to day, I'm always looking at where I need to get to, what I need to do to work on and improve at.
Have you got a favourite Spurs kit? Now, you've played against us for long enough, so you probably remember a few of them. But is there a favourite you got there? Maybe it was the one you played in.
I was a Newcastle fan growing up, right? And I actually had a Spurs shirt.
Did you?
It's so random. I had a Celtic shirt and a Spurs shirt as a kid, and then I've gone on to play for both of them.
That's madness.
But yeah, like...
How does that happen?
You know... This will show my age. Like JJB Sports.
Yeah.
Back in the day. It's they would always have like a rail of shirts that was like clearance.
Yeah.
And it was like a fiver or whatever for shirts. And I remember going, and like, I was just like... And you know, as a kid, you love every football shirt, don't you? Just be playing football in the garden and whatever shirt there is. But like, I actually ended up getting a Tottenham keeper shirt.
I think
Ian Walker used to wear.
It was multicoloured one.
It was horrendous looking. Like, looking back, I think it was like orange with sky blue.
Oh yeah, I do remember.
It was a bit of a rascal shirt, but that I had.
I think we should bring that back.
Hewlett Packard, was it?
Yeah,
I think it would have been. Yeah. I think we should bring that back next season.
Nah, I'd rather be.
What's your all-time five-a-side Spurs team?
Put me on the spot there, aren't you?
Yeah, it's hard.
Yeah. Perhaps make it your all-time five-a-side team. From the players you played with.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah, make it easier for you.
Do you have to pick yourself?
You can't have to.
You can pick yourself.
Or we go with no keeper?
No, no, we have a keeper.
Yeah, we have a keeper.
We have a keeper.
Yeah.
Right, I'll put Joe Hart in goal because he ticks the Spurs box for you guys. Keep you happy. It's got to be Harry Kane up front.
Yeah.
Do you know who I put in midfield? Who's actually played here as well? Victor Wanyama.
Yeah.
Played him at Celtic. Played him at Southampton.
Big Vic. Yes.
Incredible player.
Yeah.
Like, so destroy strong. People in midfield. Yeah. Not Spurs, but Virgil van Dijk.
Yeah, player.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, brilliant.
How many is that? There must be
four.
Oh, it's hard to pick another in there. Rooney.
Very what a player.
What a team.
There's so many I've missed.
What a team. Yeah, it's hard.
You've chucked me on the spot there.
Yeah, it's hard.
Yeah, that's what we like. What is the one piece of advice, life advice, you would give people?
There was one bit of advice that was given to me when I was in Newcastle's academy, and it was just to work as hard as you can at whatever you want to do. And then if you do that, if it happens, amazing. But obviously if you fall away or fail or whatever, you know you've given it everything.
Don't have regrets.
You've got no regrets because you've given it your all. And then I think that can transfer to pretty much every aspect of life, really.
Yeah.
In your opinion, who was the greatest ever Spurs player?
I want to say Harry Kane. I think probably when he stops playing, everyone will look back and be like,
oh, incredible.
Incredible player. And I think, do you know one of them? I'd say coming to Tottenham and then training with them every day. You'll know this, I haven't been a player. Like, you see lads in training and then they're just in your eyes. They're so, like, you know they're a great player, but then you see them day to day. And, like, his finishing, his movement, everything, just incredible.
Well, no one would argue with that, for sure, Fraser. Fraser, once again, thank you very much.
Fraser, thank you.
Good to see you.